Well, good afternoon, and a warm welcome to all of you. I'm Katherine Marshall, senior fellow at the Berkley Center here at Georgetown University. It's the Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, and my own focus is on religion and global development. We're delighted that we're able to have this event today, focusing on two books and on an important long-term focus of the Berkley Center. Unfortunately, Susan Hayward, who is the co-editor of the Women, Religion, and Peacebuilding book, was forced to stay at USIP, where she works, for a critical event that is trying to solve the problems of the world. In this case, I think, relationships with Islam. And so she simply could not break away, but she sends her apologies. And there will be other events. There's going to be another event at USIP, which will actually be the formal launch of the book. So those of you who are interested will have the opportunity to hear Susan Hayward in person. She's the head now of the Religion and Peacebuilding Program at USIP. But we have the three of us here, and our plan is for I'm going to play the dual role of moderator and also presenting the book that I'm the co-editor of. Susan Thistlethwaite will focus on some of the same themes, but also on her book. And then José Casanova will give a commentary and will open it up to all of you. And I'm sure you'll have a lot of comments and a lot of questions. Very briefly, introducing Susan Thistlethwaite. She is a comrade in arms, I think we can say. We've known each other for a long time. As she says, her book is one that's her life journey. She's been working on it for her lifetime. And it's on the subjects of violence and women, war and peace. She has a long distinguished academic career as well as a career as an activist. So I think we're very fortunate to have her here. She's actually been on several book events recently. And José Casanova, my distinguished beloved colleague at the Berkley Center, is now in the Berkley Center as a senior fellow, but he's also in the departments of sociology and theology at Georgetown University. And he also has a long-standing, keen interest in taking on some of the difficult issues around religion and gender. So he's going to comment on this. So what I'm going to do now is shift and talk a little bit about how this book came about. We have books for sale, for those of you who are interested, at the author's discount. Unfortunately, we had a little mishap, and Susan's book did not arrive, but there are four there, and she has flyers and so forth.
You can use this, and my book is also available on ebook.
Yeah.
And actually, this address is for Palgrave, but it's cheaper on Amazon.
So in any event, and she'll introduce it, but it's Women's Bodies as Battlefield. But briefly, how did we come to do this this book? Essentially, this story starts in USIP, the U.S. Institute of Peace, which has a department of religious peacebuilding, which in a sense has had an uphill battle, because people tend to think of religious leaders and ideas as being a cause of violence, not necessarily as a major center of peacebuilding. And USIP also has a department dedicated to women's involvement in peace, following with 1325, the UN resolution that is designed to try to bring women far more into the processes of peacebuilding. But she, the two of the people involved in USIP realized that there was an extraordinary blank space. I call it a Bermuda Triangle, where you had peace building, religion, and women. And they asked us in the Berkley Center and the World Faiths Development Dialogue to explore what religiously motivated and inspired women were doing about peace. And so about four and a half years ago, this project started. And it's involved a series of meetings and a series of interviews, about 50 interviews. And I do have a sad commentary on that. This is a publication that summarizes a lot of the interviews that we have done over the years with women and with men who are interested in these issues. And this is a picture of the earliest meeting. And very sadly, two of those women are dead. One of them is Deka Ibrahim, who was a very remarkable Kenyan Muslim woman who was courageously involved in some of the most difficult issues there. She was killed in a car accident. And then Bilkisu Yusuf from Nigeria, who is actually a co-author in this book, was killed in the stampede during the Hajj just a few days ago. So they aren't victims directly of conflict, but somehow it is a metaphor that this is dangerous work, and it is one that has claimed many victims, including two of our direct colleagues. So this publication is available, as is an earlier summary, Women in Religious Peacebuilding, and now it's finally emerged in the form of this book, Women, Religion, and Peacebuilding. And what this book does, just very briefly, is that it, after introducing and reflecting sort of on the academic study and the Bermuda Triangle problem of why it has been so difficult to get attention to these issues and to these women particularly, it has examinations of four traditions, Catholic, Muslim, and then Hindu, and Buddhist, and Jewish in separate chapters, and then essentially a series of case studies from different parts of the world. So that is, in a sense, the main focus of what we have done. In the Berkley Center, we see the issues involving women and women and religion as absolutely central to the challenges of development and religion, and religion and public affairs. It is really quite extraordinary how many of the issues of conflict seem to turn around women and women's bodies, women's roles. It's in many ways there is a surface consensus around human rights and equality of men and women. And in the development world, you can describe it as an article of faith, that women's equality is one of the most important and the central explanatory factors in modernization. And yet, in many parts of the world, it's very clear that there are still many doubts. And it's for that reason that we have focused a lot of our attention, whether it's in a specific issue like malaria or housing or energy, or more directly in issues around the conflicts in the world, on issues of what does it have to do with women. So let me summarize a few of the issues that have come out in the course of our research and in the course of our writing. First, one of our concerns, because we view it as more a problem than simply a phenomenon, is the tension around feminists versus non-feminists, and the assumption that many religious women are not feminists, and that many feminists cannot be religious. And in some settings, you actually have a visible divide between women who view themselves as fighting for women's rights and women who see that as a challenge or a threat to their religious beliefs and religious roles. We see it in various ways. In one country where we had a meeting, I happened to have with Carol Lancaster, who was the dean of the School of Foreign Service, a meeting aside from one of our consultations about women, about religion and development. We met with some representatives of Vital Voices, which is the group that Milan Verveer and Hillary Clinton have been very much involved with. And we invited them, come along and see what this meeting on religion and development is doing. And they said, no, we really would just as soon not have anything to do with religion because religion is basically the problem. And very often you hear from women who are committed to religious traditions that no, we're not feminists. We're uneasy about the term feminist. Now this is to a degree artificial, and it's more pronounced in a United States polarized setting. But still, it is a significant issue, and it detracts in many ways from both the secular women's advocates and the religious women's advocates, because it draws attention away from what it is that they are trying to do. And it obscures the fact that women, despite the photographs, Susan Hayward has a website, by the way, where she posts photographs of all male religious meetings, just as a reminder that there is a problem here. But despite that fact that the visible image of religious engagement is often quite male and quite advanced in years, women tend to be more religious. And they are the backbone of religious institutions, and they are deeply involved. So the fact of this separation, the oil and water separation of the feminists and non-feminists, is unfortunate, and we're convinced in our theory of change about the importance of dialogue and discussion that more engagement will help to break down some of these barriers. The second issue that we came across, we've had several meetings where people have come together, and in every single meeting, there's been agonizing around what is called essentializing. So the pattern is generally that there's a discussion of the remarkable work that women do and the qualities that they bring to the work, whether it is knowledge or empathy or engagement with communities or commitment to families and so forth. And then at a certain point, people will say, but we must not essentialize women. All women are different. There are women who are very violent as well as women who are peace-loving. And you simply cannot generalize. You should not attribute certain characteristics to women. And this is a subject of continuing unease. How do you deal with the fact that many of us do think that there are differences at a group level, not at an individual level, in the way women approach problems and their style, but above all, and this is for me the most important, in their agendas, without getting caught in the trap of saying women are more peace-loving or women are more this or that. So this question of essentializing is important. And one of the features of that is the tendency to cast women as victims. Now, clearly, we are talking about terrible things that happen to women. Rape, domestic violence, abuse, marginalization, etc. But we also should never forget that women are active and powerful agents, that they're fearless in many cases, and so that is important. One of the ways that we are approaching this diversity and the personal stories is through case studies and through the series of interviews that I described before. A third theme, which is you see it in the title of our book, Illuminating the Unseen, is the theme of invisibility. And interestingly, in our work on this topic, the theme of invisibility attracted some attention, that these women are working, but no one sees what they're doing. And some of the women savor the role of invisibility. They see their invisibility as a way of doing things that they could not otherwise do, that they can, they're not recognized. Of course, we know from Battle of Algiers that women were able to cross barriers with bombs under their burqas, et cetera. But nobody pays much attention to women who go from place to place in many settings. And so the invisibility is a sort of cloak, as traditional myths have often focused on the benefits of invisibility. However, that is not the point. The point is that this work should be recognized, that the women do belong at the table. One of our phrases is that if you're not at the table, you end up on the menu, or you end up part of the meal, or, as Susan pointed out earlier, you end up serving the meal. And we are very convinced that the agendas that women bring in peacebuilding are often different, and they're important agendas, and they women belong at the table, which, of course, is the theme of Resolution 1325 and of everything else. But it came out in many different ways with some complexities associated with it in the research for this book. Another theme that we hear often, I actually first heard it in reference to Eritrea, but I think it's part of myths and stories, is that women are vitally important in battles, in wars, in conflict situations. They play critical roles. They provide support. They often come out of their traditional roles and are active as in the whole of the conflict. But as soon as the conflict is finished, there's a tendency to say, why don't you just go back into traditional roles, go back home, into the kitchen. Interestingly, that has been a disturbing pattern following the Arab Spring revolution, where many women were often very vital parts of the demonstrations and the mobilizations. But there's been a turning, a backlash against that in the years after the Arab Spring. So that in many situations, Aceh, many of the case studies, we've seen this pattern of women being relegated to traditional roles after a conflict is over. And that brings me to another interesting finding that even though everyone has their definitions of peace and war, where conflict resolution, where peace building starts, et cetera, but women tend to have, in our experience, a broader understanding of what's involved in peace. So that, for example, in Sewa in India, that microfinance is viewed as part of peace building and conflict resolution. In Israel, in the remarkable story here in the book about Arab Israelis and their transformational work. Again, it isn't a direct conflict, it isn't a war, but it is a very important aspect. So if you see peace building in a broader sense, clearly you have many more women who are involved. So how does that matter? It matters I've seen it directly matter in how you define the prizes, the awards that people are given in funding and so forth. So that is an important factor. Clearly, the diversity of women and their stories is an essential part of our understanding, and I think we started with an understanding of diversity, but it was accentuated as we went along. We're in a situation now where a new acronym has entered into the discussion and risks in many ways crowding out other agendas. The acronym is CVE, which is Countering Violent Extremism. And clearly there is a lot of focus in that, particularly on women in more violent roles and the recruitment of girls, the attraction of girls who are going to join the Islamic State and others. So this whole question of violent extremism has also the dimension of new forms of slavery, new forms of trafficking. The refugee issues raise all kinds of new issues. So that, I think, is the contemporary challenge and the contemporary situation. And there are many insights from the people who speak through our research and through this book that are relevant for the current situation. And what this means is that this needs to be a continuing project and a continuing focus. We're really not, this is not through. Happily, the book is published. All of the work is now available. But I think we need to see this as the beginning of an exploration rather than the end. And that means more research, finding more stories, identifying issues, and trying to reverse some of the behaviors and some of the attitudes that have colored the situation up to date. So with that, I go back into my moderator role and turn to Susan. By the way, we had hoped to get her in by Skype, Susan Hayward, but the technology defeated us. And so you'll have to hear her in another situation.
Never mind. So I'm Susan Thistlethwaite, and I've been a lifelong peace activist and also a rape crisis counselor and a domestic violence counselor, as well as a professor of theology, and for 10 long years, president of Chicago Theological Seminary. And it occurred to me in the political season of 2011, where everybody's going, war on women, war on women. You remember the last war on women. Rhetoric of forced ultrasounds and legitimate rape, and it crossed my mind, maybe this is actually a war. Maybe the war on women is not a metaphor, maybe it's actually a war. And so from 30 years of working in these two fields, I decided to see what I could do to have them talk to each other. And thus came Women's Bodies as Battlefields, Christian Theology and the Global War on Women. And I want to read you from Susan and Catherine's book. No, I wrote it down. This is from Women Peacebuilders in Post-Coup Honduras, a chapter by Monica Mayer. Honduran feminists in resistance have asserted that in contexts of war, like the one we are now living in our country, our body is turned into a site of battle, into a booty of war. The use of rape and other sexual aggressions as arms of war is the most well-known and brutal form in which armed conflicts have marked an indelible way in the life of women. Our bodies are considered and treated as territory to conquer and to demonstrate power. That is largely the argument of my book. I say, women's bodies have been turned into battlefields where violence takes place, but often the contest is not with them, but about them. The goal of establishing control over women through violence or the threat of violence is only apparently about women. It is about power. And so we have so many similar themes that that's one of the reasons we decided to do this together. Now, I am a Christian theologian. This is a book about Christianity, but and it's Western Christianity. But one of the things we've managed to do in Western Christianity is to export our violence to other parts of the world through colonialism and neocolonialism and now globalization. So we have the common theme of invisibility. And to invisibilize, that is to render, to make invisible, it's not an accident that the women in this book who are peace builders, yes, some of them prefer to work under the radar, but others are doing important work that if it were not invisibilized, could actually get more voices at the table and better resolve conflict. So that doesn't just happen by accident. There are cultural forces, social forces, economic forces, religious reasons that this happens. And so one of the things I try to do in a more macro, we're kind of a macro analytical and a case study documentation, is to say, why does that happen? Who benefits? Who benefits when violence is invisibilized? And a lot of violence is invisibilized. But also, who benefits when women in particular are invisibilized? And trying to take a look at that. Another common theme is seeing. If something is invisibilized, what do we do? What mechanisms can we employ to make something seen? And yet, violence and violence against women is one of the most seen things in culture. I challenge you to pick up any newspaper, turn on any news show, and not see violence. And a lot of it will be violence against women. But there is a veil of a lack of consciousness of connecting one to the other that is very powerful, that is very powerful. And so we need to turn seeing into witnessing, like witnessing for peace, like the African American church. Can I get a witness? Can I have somebody join me in this insight into the spirit, which is, can I get a witness? That's what it means. Don't forget, the other aspect of violence, when it is seen, is voyeurism. Violence, and particularly violence against women's body, is consumed. It's an object of desire. And I think, and I write in the book in terms of actually peace theologies and ending war. Peace theologies, and just war theory itself, totally neglected the notion of desire. Violence exists because it is desired and highly eroticized. Okay, so I call 21st century war dirty war. And this is well documented from Argentina, from Latin America in general. The cover of the book is crosses woven into chain link fences, the names of women, femicide in Bolivia, which has one of the highest rates of femicide in Latin America, because there are no memorials like Gettysburg to women killed in the war on women. Katherine and Susie's book, they say modern warfare, with its utter and often protracted social disruption, affects women disproportionately. This is another area of overlap. Conflict casualties are notoriously difficult to gather with reliability, but overall trends show that more civilians are dying in violent conflicts than ever before. And this is particularly women, children, and the elderly, the most vulnerable. This is dirty war. This is not two armies meeting on a battlefield like in World War I, you know, and just lobbing shells, one combatant against the other. This is war on the bodies of civilians. That is dirty war. And the war on women is a dirty war. And a lot of that includes the murders of women. Now, one of the things I want to focus on, because we were talking about women and religion and violence, is that in religion, women are overly symbolized. Women's bodies come in for a lot of religious symbolization, and this is, you know, across religions in different ways. And Mary Douglas's book, Purity and Danger, has an analysis of why it is that women's bodies, especially unregulated women's bodies, in terms of women not following the rules of whatever is set out is so dangerous to communities that, in fact, it must be suppressed with violence. And there's a fabulous book that I highly recommend to you. It's a wonderful title. By Bill Countryman, using Mary Douglas's thesis. It's called Dirt, Greed, and Sex, Sexual Ethics in the New Testament. So how did women's bodies get dirty? How did sex get dirty? And it comes from this press to regularize the community symbolized as women, because women reproduce, they produce the next generation. And so, you know, what goes into your body, what comes out of your body, that's all very much a part of religious symbolization. But this then comes to the point that Catherine was making earlier, that post-conflict, women can play very key roles in peace building and conflict, and, you know, from Rosie the Riveter, right, in World War II to now in the Arab Spring. But at the end of conflict, there is a desire by the community to reassert control. And one of the ways that gets done is by reasserting control over women's bodies and sometimes hyper-regulating them, their activities, sexuality. It can result in homophobia, violent homophobia, transphobia, and this happened again. I will quote again from the Honduran chapter. The connection between violence against women and state violence is made, but then post the coup in Honduras, the then president installed by coup annulled the law permitting the use and distribution of emergency contraception. According to the Center of Women's Rights in Honduras, the ultra-conservative political class, colluding with fundamentalist religious groups, turned back social and legal rights achieved by women in that country. But why? Why would the religious groups co-conspire to re-regulate women's bodies? And that is a key to understanding what connects all of this violence one to another. I'm going to leave for our conversation. I work in the area of just peace. Catherine and Susan used the phrase peace building. But I want to close with saying why, as they conclude, strengthening interfaith global networks to support women peacemakers is so important. I'm on the board of the Interfaith Youth Corps, the editor of Interfaith Just Peacemaking, and it is demonstrable that women join interfaith peace organizations and interfaith organizations at higher rates than men do. And yes, it's collaborative, and without essentializing women, it's just simply statistically the case, but women move up faster in leadership in interfaith organizations normally than they do in their own hierarchical religion. So this is a good way to promote women's religious leadership around the world to support interfaith organizations that do peacemaking in a global context. Thank you.
Yes, it works. Well, let me say it's not only a great pleasure, but a great honor to be here to comment on this book. Unfortunately, I only got your book a moment ago, so I cannot. I'm only looking forward to have a chance to read it. But I will be comment on this book, which is a great, I would say, congratulate both of you. It's truly a work of illumination, the subtitle, Illuminating the Unseen. Because so much of the work that women do, especially women of faith, religious women in peacebuilding, easily not documented. And so this is really, really fantastic, even for me that I follow the sociology of religion and interest in issues of gender and religion and peacebuilding. I follow those processes, and yet there was a lot of food for thought in this book. So I do recommend it greatly, partly because so much of it is under the radar. Under the radar is one of the metaphors throughout the book. And under the radar means two things, precisely because it is unseen, it's invisible, but also strategically, because sometimes it's done and offers opportunities to do creative things that otherwise couldn't be done. So this element both of that is not known, unseen, invisible, but also the fact that it is a way of new ways of doing things that break the customary official way, creative imagination, the courage of women, trespassing, crossing boundaries, the kind of thing that precisely are necessary for peace building. The book really, as already Katherine indicated, answers the need to basically address the dual blindness or blinders, the secularist blinders to our religion that do not realize how relevant religion is in peace building, partly because, of course, they see religion as a problem but not as a resource, and the male blinders towards women, which, of course, is the main issue of not only blinders. I mean, it's worse than one, the blindness, because it is the war on women's body, but it's also ultimately, even when there is no relationship, it's basically ignorance and not paying attention to what women do. And so the official, especially male authority, and throughout the book it shows how frequently, once the peace process begins, it is males they take over. I'll talk about this paradox. And even when they try to incorporate religion, it is male religious leaders that are brought onto the table. While in the actual creative moment of conflict and war, it is women that have really opened new possibilities. This is one of the paradoxes that is, again, very, very important in the book. The fact that, first, that wars and conflicts today are asymmetric wars, not the traditional wars between armies, and therefore they affect greatly normal civilian communities, and particularly women and children, what already Susan has pointed out. But also because of that, it is women that basically take the initiative and have the courage to respond to the crisis, being very creative, imaginative in addressing the fundamental problems, and having enough and simply, we must do something. And it's women getting together that sometimes are able to do what appears from the point of view of professional peace builders simply impossible, intractable. The really, really important structure of the book is based on the triad. Is it what Katherine referred to as the Bermuda Triangle? You have to deal with the three points or the three aspects or the three dyads. It's not only that you have a triangle. You have actually three very important dyads, each important in its own terms, but to address the fundamental issues, you have to take into account all of them, namely the dyad women religion, which is, of course, the central aspect of Susan's book and the war on women. We must recognize the fundamental problem of toward gender equality, the resistance, basically, of religious traditions to address this issue. I mean, I would not simplify that religious fundamentalism in all traditions is simply a response to the threat of feminism and gender equality, but there is much to it. And so the fact that feminism, the gender issue, I mean, I come from the Catholic Church, this is my concern, and the fact that for a long time, for the last 20 years, the very category of gender was thought to be ideological and therefore had to be discarded, because it means, if you accept the very category of gender, it means accepting feminism, accepting then going to homosexuality and same-sex marriage, and you go down the line. So the whole notion that gender is an ideological category that we have to contest. And this led to a fundamental kind of cul-de-sac or dead end that made the Catholic Church impossible to respond to those issues. Things are beginning to change, but very, very slowly. So this dyad has to be addressed. And the first part of the book the four chapters dealing with four different religious traditions basically show how different, in different religious traditions, this issue of male leadership, the fundamental stereotypes of the role of women in the tradition and so on, have to be addressed differently but are there. I will come to the very important lessons for me as a sociologist of religion as to how these different traditions deal with this issue. Religion in peacebuilding, again, is a different diet. Precisely because so many conflicts around the world today are inter-religious conflicts, inter-community conflicts in which religion appears as a problem. You have to address the role of religion in peacebuilding, because without it you cannot do it both, because when it is part of the problem, only itself can be part of the solution, but also because of the resources of the whole discourse of peace and justice and wholeness and dignity of the human person, which is built into at least part of the discourse of the hermeneutic traditions. A discourse that, of course, was controlled mainly by male authority, but that precisely women in all the religious traditions are simply reinterpreting those traditions through female eyes, through their own agency, and through our own reading of the sacred text. And women and peace building, again, the fundamental diet, because so much of, we know, the structural causes of these asymmetric conflicts is basically injustice, inequality, basically structural violence, and women are at the very center of it. Women are the ones that are the recipients, the victims, but also they've shown throughout all these conflicts that they have the resilience to respond in creative ways. So the important lesson of the book is that you have to deal with all three dyadic relationships: women, religion, religion, peace building, women and peace building. And it's only by taking all three together that we can address the fundamental question precisely of building just and lasting peace, which can only be done if we address those fundamental problems which are built into these relationships. Let me ask, again, the fact that sexual and gender-based violence has been so central to violent conflicts in the last decades indicates so much the point that Susan has made, but also the fact that precisely women respond in creative ways to address this problem. Now let me simply give a brief comments about the chapters on. They are very rich chapters. You have to deal with read all of them. For me, as a social scientist, the really, really lesson of the book is: do not generalize too easily in any way. Do not stereotype women. Do not stereotype gender. Do not generalize too quickly. The contextual differences, both religious contexts and the very different local contexts within the same religious tradition. You find radically different contexts within Muslim, with the difference between Aceh, Mindanao, and Nigeria. Three very different Muslim contexts, but how different the response, because the problems are very different. So you cannot generalize about Islam or about specific gender relations, which are typical. And the same goes for different Catholic contexts, in which people simply, the problems are somewhat different. The need, therefore, to take very seriously the contextual difference. Let me address the difference between the four religious traditions very briefly. Obviously, for me, the Catholic chapter was particularly illustrative. It's a great chapter by Marian Cusiman Olaf, a professor at Catholic University, American Catholic University. And what basically she points out is that women within the Catholic Church are under the radar. But of course, they are the basically what keeps the whole church together. They are double the number of nuns, religious women, than priests. And they are really the ones that both are, if you wish, in the front lines. They are in the grassroots. And the paradox, if you wish, that it is today religious women, and I would argue religious men, namely the religious orders, both male and female, which are really underground. They are really in the world. They are incarnated. They are embedded in communities, in the grassroots. while the priests, the clerics, basically have the task of administering the ecclesiastical institution. So it is the women that are really the kind of church that Pope Francis calls for, a kind of a battlefield hospital. And they are the women which are really, really there at the, in the in this front. And it is these fundamental, they are under the radar, and because of that, they can do things that the male hierarchy allows them to do. We know what happened when they become too visible. Sometimes you have the attempt on the part of the curia and the bishops to silence them, as happened with the American religious women. At least now, at least Pope Francis has tried to indicate that he loves them, and he loves the work they do, and that he respects it as the most fundamental mother of church, precisely, that he is bringing. The other point is the tremendous resources which the Catholic Church has as a global organization in every respect of health institutions, the largest global institution of health, of education, therefore of education also of women, but also of involvement at the community level in all kinds of development issues. But this is really a resource which is not utilized. It's a great responsibility on the part of the Catholic Church to use its resources in a way that is not being done, because on the one hand you have the hierarchy, you have the very kind of transnational structure, but there is no really horizontal networks. One of the important lessons of this book is the way in which women are able to do across traditions, across communities, horizontal networking in a way without using the typical established institutional hierarchies that male have established. And the Catholic Church can only do really, really great things on the globe. The things need to be done if it is able to cut through the hierarchies and do the transnational network of Catholic groups, Catholic women, Catholic peace builders, Catholic women working for development, etc. And this is the kind of one, I think, of the great insights of the book. I don't want to waste more time on the Catholic Church. But let me just simply say why women and peace building is important in this issue. I mean, Pope Francis has been saying, repeating again and again, when it comes to issues of environment, when it comes to issues of war, when it comes to of globalization economy, it is the poor that suffer the most. It's the poor and the poor and the poor. And I'm going, and Pope Francis forgets, women are the poorest of the poor in every religious tradition, in every community in the world. They are the most marginalized, they are the most invisible. So it is precisely the task of, should be the task of Pope Francis to bring visibility not only to the poor and the sufferers in all these processes, but this to be precisely the female face of the poor and of suffering, and the resources that women bring precisely to respond to these challenges. Just very briefly, on the theater traditions. The issue that is very clear in working with anything with Islam. On the one hand, the problem, the challenge of patriarchy and how much is embedded in the tradition. On the other hand, the fact that only Muslim women really have the courage and the resources to respond to it. That if it comes from the outside, from women, secular feminists, very little can be done, precisely for the reasons which are very clearly explained in the chapter on Islam and peace building. You need to bring the resources of the tradition, of the Muslim tradition, the resources, the values, and the whole models of authority, if you wish, also, but have to be reinterpreted. I was fortunate to have my first encounter with Islam professionally. I mean, it's when sisters in Islam from Malaysia invited me to a conference on challenging fundamentalism. And I simply never accepted the notion that patriarchy and fundamentalism is intrinsic to Islam. This was my first encounter with Islam, sisters in Islam. And so it is like if your encounter with Catholicism is true liberation theology, you are not going to listen to what the Vatican says all the time. You realize it's a much more complex story. And so ultimately, the lesson also of this book is that only religious women can basically be a fundamental force in reinterpreting those traditions which are part of the problem. And religious women are really, really the resource that have to be used to fight those or to transform those traditions. And the thing is that those traditions, at the beginning, all of them are much more open, all of them. The sacred texts are always much more open than the way the traditions became institutionalized through male. And so there is a way of for women to reinterpret in their own ways those sacred texts. And this is, of course, what feminist theologians have been doing for such a long time. The Buddhists, the notion of the Oriental, the Eastern tradition is now, while the Western traditions, monotheistic traditions, Islam, Judaism, Christianity, basically have a long tradition of working on justice, equality, structural relationships in the world. The Eastern tradition is much more inner-oriented, transformation of the self. But there is a great also resource in doing that. Recognition that ultimately the fundamental problems of violence, of violent relationships in the community level also have to do with our own, if you wish, problems of internal relationship and our own conceptions of the self. And so it is very important to understand the links between those, if you wish, damaged relationships within, with ourselves, with God, with nature, with the other, to understand precisely the external structural problems in society that have to be addressed. There is a great chapter on how the importance of bringing back women into the Buddhist tradition, female monasticism, which of course originally was part of the Buddhist tradition, but completely disappeared from the Buddhist tradition, and the need to bring religious women central to, as is happening, reform, engaged Buddhism. It is women which are at the forefront of new forms of engaged Buddhism. And finally, a very important lesson from Judaism, the lesson of accepting argumentation, diversity, plurality, not closing, not looking for uniformity. This is the great, I think, resource that Judaism has to offer. Because, you know, the Western tradition has been uniformity. Una Santa Catholica Apostolica Ecclesia. Unity. So that in the religious world, the problem was that even those who wanted to have concordance, who wanted to have dialogue, could not accept the possibility of multiple Christian churches. Could not accept pluralism within the Christian tradition. Only the sects did, but by breaking away and by being thrown away. They ended up, of course, in the New World, and they developed a model of religious pluralism. But the Jewish resistance to uniformity, Christians telling them, you are superseded, the Old Testament is superseded, you should become universalists like us. And then the Muslims repeating the same. And then the Enlightenment, universalism, repeating the same. You are particularists. You are tribal. Forget. No, this resistance to be incorporated into one single uniformity, which I think the greatest gift of the Jewish tradition. And this is what emerges here in this tradition of argumentation. You know, the joke about a single Jew in an island that and somebody comes and has two synagogues. And this is the synagogue I go to, this is the synagogue I don't go to. So this notion of this internal fundamental disagreement with your own tradition, which and not to close, not to bring uniformity, is what we need, of course, in our pluralist world, the recognition that pluralism is intrinsic to humanity, and we can only really build a lasting, peaceful, global structures if we accept this pluralism and their capacity to listen. And this is perhaps, there is something which women bring to the table. Their capacity to listen. They've been forced to listen so long. They were not allowed to talk. Fortunately. So they have this great gift, and something that obviously we males have to learn how to listen. And this is a book that basically tells us how to listen to these women's voices. And so you should go and read it.
Well, thank you, Jose, and thank you very much, Susan. And now it's time to open it up and see who would like to speak. We have mics, and if you would just introduce yourself quickly and say who you'd like to address it to. So, any questions or comments? Okay, we start with Mr. Olson.
Yes.
Yeah, Mike.
A lot of discussion about conflicts and how they get resolved and why they don't get resolved. Oh, sorry. Tom Olson is my name. I was thinking, are there parts in the of the world where there is considerably less conflict and fewer problems with the relationship between men and women? And it occurred to me that this may be the case in Scandinavia. Iceland, Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Finland, they seem to have many fewer conflicts, and they seem to be more egalitarian when it comes to relationships between men and women. Women are very involved in politics and many other subjects, but I see Susan has something to say about that.
Well, you know, it's funny you should say that, because Katherine and I were actually talking about long plane flights before the event started, and I was on a dissertation committee in Finland at the University of Helsinki, because a woman in that all-male faculty student wanted to write on feminist liberation theology, and they could not find anyone in the whole of Finland who could direct that dissertation, so they flew me in. And there are aspects, certainly, of a society where you can have parental leave, where you can, you know, I mean, there's some very good social policy within the Scandinavian countries. But to talk to the Finnish women over the years that I was working with her on that dissertation, you know, you think about Norse mythology, you think about the influence of the Lutheran Church, I think there's a tremendous amount of domestic violence in the Scandinavian countries. There actually has been recently a documentary on, I don't want to misstate this, but I think it is Sweden. And it is unacknowledged. So, you know, it's kind of like Anna Karenina. They're unhappy in their own way. So I am not certain that that is generalizable country to country. But the one that I do know a fair amount about is Finland. And if you can't find one feminist theologian in your entire country, that does seem to me to be a flag that we're not looking at transformative understandings of, in this case, gender and religion. So that one I do know something about. And yet, you know, I think we could get agreement on the panel that better social policy, higher economic standards across your country, protections for women in the workplace, that Scandinavian countries have that to a greater degree than many countries, certainly than the United States does. It helps a lot. It's just not everything.
If I may add, I mean, it's a general issue, of course, of developed societies. European societies, they were able to for a while, as long as they were uniform. But the problem they have in incorporating immigrants, all Scandinavian societies, Denmark. Denmark, of course, is the most egalitarian society, the most secular and the most Lutheran at the same time. Everybody is Lutheran and everybody is secular. Nobody goes to church. So if you are either religious or not Danish, you cannot be part of the society. The difficulty of society is to accept difference. It's very, very strange.
Yeah. Good point.
And just one other comment on that theme. If there is a magic bullet that people point to, it's education. And the dramatic changes in education across Scandinavia, I think in the interwar period, but it goes way back, is what many Scandinavians attribute. I think they're a much more fundamental social belief in equality between men and women, which is, in those societies, as you point out from the ancient myths, a huge change. So anybody else?
Yes. Son, hello. Yes, I'm just wondering, have any of you sent these books to... Oh, my name is Jerry Critchley. I'm just wondering if any of you have sent these books to Hillary Clinton and Ambassador Verveer and Vital Voices. I mean, Vital Voices is such a powerful organization of women and has quite a visibility. And the fact that they don't want to talk at all about religion just really surprised me. I mean, they're almost, you know, keeping the stereotype going instead of counteracting it.
Whether it's reached Hillary Clinton, I don't know. The Vital Voices was, this was a couple of women in another country, and we just saw the level of discomfort in that particular example, which is an illustration of what I think is quite unease of many secular women about religious women, and let's be very clear about many religious women about what they see as bra-burning, aggressive feminists. I mean, people often link aggressive and feminist. And clearly these are stereotypes, but it is important to break it down.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, maybe Vital Voices should have a special award ceremony just for women within the religious tradition and really confront this and bring this issue out and talk about feminism and religion and the importance of women and visibility and acknowledgement and power.
Let's suggest that.
Yes, well, you have an ear of Ambassador Vivier. So,
hi, thank you. My name is Ella Duncan. I work with Search for Common Ground on the Deeming for Peace project, and actually I'm also working with the Effective Interreligious Action for Peacebuilding program, which is a heck of a title, but I'd be really interested in your research. Did you find any evidence, even anecdotal evidence, of what actually happens when women, religious women, are included in peace processes and how that really changes the outcome of them or what kind of sustainability that is able to help peace achieve?
I'm not up on the latest statistics on this, but I think there still is only one woman's signature affixed to a peace agreement, which is Miriam Colonel Ferrer from the Philippines. And she was here last week, and she's been here a couple of times. So we have fragments of information, but of course the basic pattern, if you just look at the photographs of, you know, Myanmar and Syrian peace discussions, there were some on the Central African Republic. I mean, that's why Susan Hayward collects photographs of all male panels and discussions and leaders. So the direct experience is awfully fragmentary. My own experience, and it does come out of a lot of the interviews that I think is most significant. I mean, there are two sort of, when you get into the essentializing business, there are two characteristics that people feature. One is the listening capacity, the empathy, the ability, whether it's through common shared experience with children and families, to reach out and to see across lines, to hear another story. That I think, so, and again, even in management analyses, women are seen as not always, but often bringing a different, more inclusive style. I have a whole series of war stories, if you ever want to hear them, from years of being a manager in the World Bank setting. And then the second, which to me is easier to document and in many ways more tangible, is different agendas. And just as an illustration, we've done a lot of work on what we call 10 promises for women and 10 promises for children, for mothers and children, which is essentially ideas that religious leaders can advance within religious traditions to save lives of mothers and children and improve their welfare. And it's not easy to get a hearing for these issues in traditional settings. But when you deal with the women's assemblies, there's huge resonance. It's simply that agendas are different. And if you do surveys of villages and ask what they want, the men may want a road and the women may want water. Or they may focus on issues for the school or for children's health. So it is different agendas. And those agendas, I think the Aceh story brings that out fairly clearly. and some of the others that those issues and Mindanao and the obviously the issue of domestic violence, which is a taboo issue so often, bringing those issues out. So it's style and agendas that seem to make the biggest difference, and it's part of the rationale between the UN Resolution 1325 that you want women at the table because they bring a different tone and style and agenda.
Can I respond to that just a little bit? Lema Gimbawi's book, Mighty Be Our Powers, which I actually rely on a fair amount, and it's the Liberian women's experience in relationship to their peace process. And there were, and if I'm not mistaken, three women when there was a peace process in relationship to the Liberian conflict. But they were elite women, and the talks had stalled, and Lema Gimbawi and her grassroots women, who are both Christian and Muslim, go, and they demonstrate, and they say they're not going to let the men out of the peace negotiations, so they come up with something concrete. But then they're invited in, and they say no, because they don't want to undermine the three women who were asked to be there. So it's a very concrete example of how women and representation and issues, and one of the things they're trying to get into the conversations is allocation of resources for trauma recovery. And that's something that Susan and Katherine bring up, I bring up, the need to use trauma theory in relationship to helping societies recover from conflict, which is something these women want, and the male peacekeepers in particular just, what do you want that for? You know, so it's also allocation of resources post-conflict, and where do those resources go in relationship to helping societies recover or not? So it's a good resource for you if you want to think further on that.
My name is Peter Fan of Theology Department here. I'm very proud that one of my students, Susan Hayward, is the so I will advertise that to our department. My question to you, Catherine, is that when you work on this, have you, I haven't read the book, I just bought it, but have you worked with communist societies? And communist society like China and Vietnam. And I raise this question because these situations are very peculiar. On the one hand, officially, ideologically, non-religious or atheist. On the other hand, they are the one who combated patriarchy in the form of Confucianism in the most radical way. So that here you have non-religion, and yet you have this egalitarian model of society, at least in theory, but I see also in practice. So whether that situation would kind of give you another perspective with your research. And one more detail for you. You mentioned the fact that women were engaged in war and violence during the war, and that is precisely the case of Vietnamese women in the north. When the American bombs them, the bridges, so they were the women who come out and rebuild the bridges and so forth, and they are vital in the war against the Americans. And after the war, they were the ones who were most recognized by the communist government, especially the women who have fought in the war and lost children. They are the ones who are given honor, special places in society. So my question is whether in those situations your research would kind of modify.
Well, in many senses, the research or the examples, the stories that we have, do bear out the basic narrative that women are vital during the times of war, that they change roles, that they are in many unconventional roles, but that once the conflict is over, there are strong pressures that revert to traditional patriarchal patterns. And that you hear stories of that in China, Vietnam, certainly in Cambodia, dramatically. I mean, the issues of trafficking, the issues of basic bias against women in leadership positions are very strong. I think Thailand is another situation Japan clearly has many strong patriarchal traditions. So it is this narrative that in times of crisis, it shakes everything up and does break down a lot of the barriers, but that there is also a strong pressure to revert to traditional patterns once the normal situation returns.
I'm Kathleen Carroll. Thank you very much for this publication, this work. I actually attended the Women Leading Peace Symposium last week, and it's very timely. It's also timely. You mentioned the CVE, Countering Violent Extremism. Not all women are the peace builders. They're actually the extremists. And can you speak to how this work can counter that? I mean, there's this high recruitment to ISIS, including the Americans, these lone wolf attacks. So how can we contain that?
Okay, let me take that. Do you want the? I think one of the greatest puzzles that people are facing is what is contributing to the violent extremism and to the sudden rise of ISIS. There's an article in the New York Review of Books by Anonymous that essentially says we've in many ways hit the analytic wall. In other words, there's a great deal that I think is really not understood. And one of the greatest puzzles, the thing that people talk about at dinner parties and in academic conferences, is what is attracting particularly Western girls, teenage girls, to go to be brides of ISIS. And there are theories, but I don't think any plausible explanations. I think the most important point is that one of the dangers of overgeneralizing and of essentializing is the idea that women are peace-loving, tender, loving creatures in all situations, because that clearly is not true. Mia Bloom has a book about some of the violent tendencies of women, and there can be horrible brutality that women provoke, and the cruelty of some women to other women is again something that jars and that is a reality we have to deal with. So you have to take that into account in any analysis of women and peace. But again, it's the same as this dyad of religion and peace, that simplistic assumptions don't help us very much. I think you have to look to a number of things. One is we really need to focus on grievances. In other words, what are the grievances that people hold in their minds? Real and grievances of memory and of psychology or wounded history, as people call it. So I think that is one of the vital things that needs to be taken into account. And then obviously the resources for peace, building on the strengths that women, in this case we're looking at women, can bring, and the creative, the different insights, the different experiences that are able to transcend some of the barriers. And I think Susan was referring to the wonderful case of Liberia, and there's a similar one in Sierra Leone, and I think a similar one actually in the Philippines that was described last week of basically at a certain point women, and Sudan, there's another case in the Sudan where the women basically just say, enough is enough. And whether it's a Lysistrata tendency where the women go on sexual strike or whether they simply deal with their sons and say, this is not gonna happen anymore. I think those are stories that are worth highlighting and tendencies to build.
So I just wanna highlight that countering violent extremism is a way of framing that focuses attention on some things but closes off others. And both of us, through Peacebuilding, and I'm writing about just peace, more energy needs to be put into, more money needs to be put into preventing violent extremism. And that if we over-militarize, we say in the peace movement, you mirror your enemy, you become your enemy. You start thinking that way and you get stuck. So, I mean, one of the advantages women bring to the table often in many of these countries is they're not over here doing the military planning. Other ideas occur to them. So let's also think about PVE, preventing violent extremism, and what this book outlines in terms of case studies, and then the conclusion in terms of practical analysis. My last two chapters are, here's, 10 things you can do right now. You need to not be sucked in by the phraseology violent extremism, because it does take all the air out, or it takes a lot of the air, and it takes a lot of the money out of what do we do in this. And that includes, now looking at women and girls as victims of violent extremism, and then it replays the whole, ain't it awful, they're victims, and what women are doing in their communities to prevent violent extremism in the countries ISIS is, for example, or ISIL, or whatever you want to call it, gets ignored. So be careful with that phraseology, because it can really distract you.
Yeah, my name is Rafia Saeed, and I have an interfaith organization of my own, which we started immediately after 9/11. So you afterwards what we do. Yeah, I have a comment. I don't have a question. So number one is that I really appreciate this word. You said generalizing everything. That's very important for us, because what we see, we don't have a right resources. I will talk about Islam because I am Muslim. So we don't have a general, this right resources where we can get information what's happening, except seeing ISS and all those things, which are all very troubling for all of us in general. So we have to have some right resources where we can get the real information about what Islam and Muslims. That's very important. If anyone can help for that, that would be appreciated. I have a request to media. I don't know if they are here or not. But when I see media people on TV in war zones, I pray for them that they should be safe, no matter who they are. So I really, we respect them and we have great respect for media. But there is a little bit problem, because when something happens not right, people are on TVs and radios. There are controversial personalities who hate Islam themselves and who have not understood. That has to be, some attention has to be given to that also. Number two, as long as Muslim women rights are concerned, we have birth rights for everything. We don't have to fight for that. Unfortunately, it is the society, it's the culture which makes women to fight for it. For example, we have vote, we were fighting here for the vote, and we have birth right to vote for anybody who will be the best person to, lead the country. And also, you are with Chicago Seminary.
Yes, I am.
You know Ingrid.
Oh, yeah.
You know
Ingrid Mattson. Yes,
Ingrid Mattson.
Well. Yeah.
He is a Muslim woman. He was the president of the Islamic Society of North America, which is the largest Muslim society's group in this country. So many people like that. So it's very important for us, for all of us, that not generalizing, but going to the sources, which are very important. That will make some difference in the world.
Great. Are there any other comments or questions?
My name is Mike Newroth with the United Church of Christ. I really appreciate juxtaposing these two books together and how they speak to one another. It strikes me, having read Susan's book, Susan, at the end of your book, you talk about a more embodied just peacemaking. I'm kind of wondering what the same thing would be for a more embodied peace building. And so for both of you to consider, what are those qualities? I think certainly what women bring among the many, unique gifts is that contribution on, ending that bifurcation between the body and the spirit, the body and the mind. you know, a feminist critique, and appreciate, you know, getting over that the disembodiment that we so easily adhere to through our, particularly the mechanisms of war, the cyber war that we're engaged in, through drone warfare, through torture, through trafficking. And so what I'm trying to wrap my mind around, what would a more embodied just peacemaking approach, a more embodied that women can contribute through peacebuilding, really look like?
Okay. Thanks, Mike. You know, I've already mentioned trauma theory, right? I mean, one of the things that, you know, we took us a long time to end the Vietnam War, but body bags, the body bags being unloaded into American living rooms every night, and then the banning of photographs from war zones, and the fight to get even any photograph of the dead in their human remains containers. They tried to take body bags out of it and rename them to hide them. And finally, President Obama went to Dover Air Force Base and met the first plane after he changed the rule about photographing the dead. People die in war. And so the first thing to embody is the fact that, you know, you get a lot of dead people in the war on women and in war, and you get a lot of injury and wounding. And so when we think about our peace efforts, we have to take the wounds of the body seriously, both in terms of prevention, but then also in terms of society's recovering, because the body politic was wounded, and grievously wounded very often. And so you'll find woven through those chapters, as well as through my book, seeing the wounds, naming the wounds, talking about what happens to women, and not letting it get shoved off stage, that it doesn't matter.
One of the expansions of this idea of not oversimplifying and being willing to contend with the complexity and the diversity of the issues that we're talking about is that I hesitate and I'm uneasy about an effort to divide the world of religion and the world of the secular world. In other words, even women of faith jars with me, because I think, again, everyone has faith, and it happens in very different ways. So to suggest, for example, that there is a different agenda for women of faith, or for not people who are non-believers, or who are nuns, or who are atheists, I think is something that takes us in the wrong direction. I think, though, my answer would be that the work that we've done accentuates the links between the violence of daily life, and particularly the violence of poverty, and the violence of war. And the difference between the women who die in childbirth, or children who die before their fifth birthday because they don't have the resources, they don't have the knowledge, is not very far removed from the horrors that we're seeing now in Syria. And this is one of the insights, I think, that has come from many of the women that we've spoken to, that the falsity of trying to draw too sharp a line, particularly in today's asymmetrical war. And this is the metaphor that's used is a war against poverty, which I think is an unfortunate metaphor, but in a positive sense, it means that you commit yourself in the same way that you would commit yourself in a life and death struggle to an effort to make sure that children don't die, that women don't die, etc. And what the faith dimension brings, that's always our question. What's religion got to do with it? Why does it matter? And what does that mean in terms of policy? I think it forces you to deal with the ethical issues and the complexities and the diversity of situations and the complexity of those dividing lines. So certainly for many of the women here, the work that they do is not organizing a military expedition or even welcoming the bodies back. It is the work of trying to improve people's lives, which again is what is the real answer to the crises that we face. So I think that we have come to a stopping point. Oh, there are two more, I guess. So why don't we take two more, and then we'll you have to leave. You have to take the short. Let's take the two together.
All right.
This is on. So my name is Jen, and I'm the founder of Four Girls Global Leadership, and I focus on the next generation of women leaders around the world, and how we can really empower them to be agents of change. And now we see that everywhere with Malala, and they really are kind of bordering between development and secular versus peace building. And I wonder how much of this is really language, because now I speak at universities and I've made the human rights argument, and the women at the table would say, oh, that's so nice. Then I made the economic argument, and people who are economists and the World Bank, they say, well, what a great idea. It really hasn't been until recently that I made the national security argument, that government, civil society, everyone, even individuals, because we all care about our security, that it has really amplified and getting the attention of people and really leaders. So I wonder how much of this, like when we say peace building, it's like, oh, that's so nice, it's women at the table. But when we make the countering violent extremism case, everyone shows up.
Yes, mine's just a simple one. What are the most important next steps that you all think are the most important things to do?
Human security was a term that was very popular and that still is in some circles. And basically, it's an effort, first of all, to break down some of the barriers between a more military perspective or security perspective and one that looks at social and economic development. And I think that is the essence of it, that that the problems, particularly when you're in a place, as I was this weekend, actually, in Bangladesh, it's inseparable, the questions of physical security and of social economic opportunity and education and health. Clearly, at the moment, there's a huge focus on CVE, and it's largely come out of this Hydra-headed monster that has developed in terms of ISIS and Boko Haram and al-Shabaab and the Taliban, and it's so much present for anyone who's living with the realities of those parts of the world. The good thing about it is that it does focus on these different, on the linkages among these different problems. The disadvantage is that people fear that it means that the security lens and the money that goes into security will drive the way that people look at other dimensions. Quickly to answer the question of what next, first of all, this is the beginning, not the end. First of all, there are a lot of traditions that we haven't looked at. Prominent among them are the peace churches, a lot of the smaller religious traditions. So there's a great deal of work that is important to continue, and there are many, many more stories that are very much worth looking at. So that's a first thing. I think there is, and from the meeting last week, it was very clear the focus on women's roles in formal peace discussions, but also in the broader set of peace work is vitally important, and we're nowhere near there. So that's a second issue, is to try to break down, to try to highlight the good work that's being done, but also to ask questions when women are not at the table. And then I think to deal with these issues on the cusp, whether it's domestic violence and engaging religious leaders. You know, for a long time, people genuinely didn't know that domestic violence was present in all societies at all levels. The figures are stunning coming out of surveys around the world. And so it was understandable, perhaps, that people thought this was a problem that was somewhere else. And that congregations and religious leaders didn't talk about it. There's no excuse anymore for not talking about domestic violence and for some of the issues of for example, mistreatment of domestic workers, which is bordering on trafficking, which is present in Washington, D.C. There are plenty of cases in this city. So I think that the agenda is, first of all, clearly in these crisis zones in the world, but it extends well beyond into daily life and into political agendas, as was pointed out in the current campaigns. So we have a lot of work to do, and we hope to continue it with your support. And with that, thank you all very much indeed, and thank you to my wonderful...